for tapes, CDs, DVDs to our publication Voices from His Excellent Glory, Declaring the Kingdom. Write P.O. Box 21516, Hot Springs, Arkansas, zip 71903. Our website is www.LakeHamiltonBibleCamp.com and LHBCOnline.com. There are hundreds of free audio files there. It's like going to Bible school at home. This is the 2016 Labor Day Deliverance Camp Meeting being held at Lake Hamilton Bible Camp in Hot Springs National Park, Arkansas. Saturday afternoon, September the 3rd, 2016. Randy Ritchie is the speaker of the service, teaching on the spirit of trauma.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon. Lord's good, isn't he?
Yes.
How many feel some loads lifted?
Yes.
Amen. Let me pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you that you're a good, good, good Father.
Yes.
You love us. We love you. And we need you. And we're thankful. Thankful, Lord, that we can love you because you first loved us. Thank you, Father, for this progressive walk that we're being taken from glory to glory. Thank you, Father, that you love us just like you are, like we are. But you love us too much to leave us this way. Thank you for that, Lord. We are a work in progress. Father, I thank you for the territory taken so far from the enemy. And I thank you, Lord, that you're raising up a people that will hold that territory in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father, that you're mighty in battle. You're worthy to be praised. Thank you, Lord, you've given us authority over all the power of the enemy, that we trample on serpents and scorpions in Jesus' name. Even the young lion and the adder we step upon in the name of Jesus. We take our protection, Lord, from under the shadow of your wings, and that nothing is impossible with you, and if you be for us, who can be against us? I repent for us all, Lord, where we've fallen short, even today, in word and deed. In the name of Jesus, we come to you through the blood of the Lamb of God, Jesus. Jesus, you did it all. Lord Jesus, you are a warrior. You are the captain of the Lord's army. So, Lord, come and fight for us.
Right.
We thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. We bind the strong man. Bind mind-blinding spirits, deaf-dumb spirits, fear, rejection, anger. Bind that with that would mask. Well, find anything that would mask and shield God's people from your truth in the name of Jesus. Bind all of the machinations of the enemy and every evil imagination projected against this group of people in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I'm going to talk to you today about trauma. How many people have been through traumatic experiences?
Amen.
Should be everybody. We'll deal with what's working in lives later. Everybody. If you're alive on the face of the earth, you have experienced trauma at some point in your life. I've often talked to people about things going on in life, and I tell them, well, you have this problem and this is what's going on. They say, how do you know? It's because you're alive and breathing on the face of the earth. I mean, we got issues here, right? By definition, trauma is an overwhelming life event that renders one helpless and are fearing for his or her life. Trauma overwhelms abilities to cope and is outside the range of normal experience. Traumatic experiences typically take place beyond the parameters of collective consciousness. It remains often in the subconscious mind. Trauma throws into question and can destroy healthy beliefs about God, self, and others acquired if you have, even when you have, godly parents, good school, good culture, good people around you. A traumatic event, even in a place where you're living in a healthy environment. Most of us live in dysfunctional environments. And everybody does to a varying degree. Amen? Trauma is an emotional response to a terrible event like an accident, a rape, or a natural disaster. Immediately after the event, shock and denial are typical. Longer-term reactions include amnesia, unpredictable emotions, flashbacks, strained relationships, and even physical symptoms like headaches or nausea. While these feelings are normal, some people have difficulty moving on with their lives. You know, there's a reaction to stuff. You know, when somebody dies, you're supposed to grieve them for a while. Biblically, we can see a pattern which God allowed Israel to mourn Moses for 30 days. And then he says, get up. It's time to move on. So if you're... That doesn't mean you ever quit missing a loved one that dies. You know, if you're born again, you should have that, and you know that they're in heaven, you should have that knowledge that it's a whisper of time before we're back with them again. That is called our blessed hope and assurance. If we're going to be resurrected and we'll join those that have gone on, but most of all, we'll all be with Jesus when we're born again. That's hope. And that's what you counter things with when the enemy is trying to make you feel hopeless because somebody born again has moved on. You have to be able to say, shut up, devil, I'm going to see him again. Yeah. You have to fall back on that. Only the Holy Spirit can truly comfort you in an event like that, and He's more than willing to when you turn to Him. I've seen people get grace that you couldn't even believe in circumstances that are beyond the measure of what's really bearable. Amen? But with the Holy Spirit, we can do all things. But if you're still stuck, if it's 2 months, 3 months, 4 months, 5 months, 6 months, 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, 7 years down the road, you're still stuck from the trauma of someone passing away, you've got to get free of that. You've got to move on. It's not meant for us to be stuck. We're moving towards the promised land. We can't be stuck in the desert. You hear what I'm saying? It's time to move on. Doesn't mean you quit loving them. Now, I want to stress that. That doesn't mean you won't have moments where you miss them, where you think about them, where a tear comes to your eyes. That's okay. But are you stuck? Everybody say, I don't want to stay stuck. Anywhere. Over anything. In Jesus' name. Some specific causes of trauma or bad experience that upset someone. Makes you feel very upset, afraid, shocked. It can be medical. A serious injury or shock to the body as from violence. Somebody's violence against you or even an accident. Remember this. The demons can cause an accident and then enter you because of the damage done by the accident. And you could have an accident and they'll enter you because of the accident. They're looking for any opening. They're looking for any opening. So, you know, they have another set of circumstances. I'm going to say this. I don't believe there's really ever an accident. I think that's a name we try to give to something. But if you really understand that there's this cosmic chess match going on, and we're the game pieces, and we're going to agree with God and be protected by Him and move with Him, or we get off into this zone over here where we're not being protected by Him, and the devil orchestrates this person to drive this car this day to be distracted, and the same thing's going on with that one, and boom, there it is. There's no chance on this earth. There's always a cause. But for the sake of our language of events that happen that are collision type, what we call an accident. Somebody falls and gets hurt, we'll call them an accident. Spirit of trauma can enter your life through accident, emotional abuse, physical abuse, sexual abuse, shock, verbal abuse, violence, etc. Amnesia is a defense. How many people in here? I don't even expect you to raise your hands, but do you have parts of your childhood that you don't remember? Parts of your childhood you don't remember. Parts of life you don't remember. Amen? Now listen, I told you a little bit of my story. Back in my day, that marijuana and all that stuff is where you lost your memory in the cloud. And now you save it in the cloud. Let's put that aside. Back to amnesia. Okay? It's a defense mechanism. And it may very well be something God gives human beings out of mercy in order to keep them alive. But it may keep you alive, but it doesn't cause you to thrive. And the only way that you're going to thrive is if you allow the Holy Spirit to take you back and to expose those places and bring your memories back so that you can go and you can listen, you can trust God. He's not going to hurt you. He wants to make it better. But until those things get exposed, and we have to give him permission, and when they get exposed, now we can bring them up, bring Jesus into the moment. Because now listen, he's not subject to time, right? Jesus is not subject to time. He's eternal. God was yesterday, today, and tomorrow. But he was there in that time, and we need to be allow ourselves to go back there and let him heal us in the moment. Sister prayed this morning for arrested development. Okay? Each of the things that happened at those moments. In arrested development, we prayed over it, but just in a quick nutshell, it means something that stops your spiritual growth. Something that stops your maturity. How many know there's 50-year-olds that act like 10-year-olds? Amen? They got something happened. It does that immaturity. So it stops your spiritual growth. It stops your soulless growth. And it happens with every sin perpetrated against you and the sins that you get involved in. Okay? We've got to let the Lord in. Everybody who will say, Lord,
Lord,
I want you coming in.
I want you coming in.
I want you shining your light.
I want you shining
in the deep, dark, hidden places.
That
need to be exposed.
To
your light.
So I can be healed.
In Jesus' name. Some label the phenomenon of the process whereby the mind avoids conscious acknowledgement of traumatic experience as dissociative amnesia. Others use terms such as repression, dissociative state, traumatic amnesia, psychogenic shock, or motivated forgetting. All that aside, there is a near universal scientific acceptance of the fact that the mind is capable of avoiding conscious recall of traumatic experience. You know, we can look at what science does. They're not the final answer. But their recording of things can also be looked at in a spiritual nature, and you can look at it and see what the devil's doing to people. Amen? Scientific evidence. I said that already. Okay, here we go. Scientific evidence shows that it's not rare for traumatized people to experience amnesia or delayed recall of the trauma. So there can be total amnesia, or there can be a time frame of amnesia in which something isn't recalled for a while and then it comes to a person. Amnesia, now listen, you know, it's in the mind. You know, there's nothing that's ever gone in your mind that's not still there. Only by the grace of God can we pray some of those nasty things out of there. But we can. And we can invite God in to take away images that don't belong. To take away triggers and feelings and flashbacks and all those things. He's capable. Now, demons, now listen, they know where it's at. They know where it's at. They know where the images are. They go get them and put them back in your face to torment you. Amnesia has been reported in combat for crimes and for concentration camp experiences and torture. Evidence of this process can be found in the early literature, even in World War I and World War II. Here's some quotes from researchers. It will be seen that certain disturbances are common to all. Amnesia, varying from complete obliterations of the past to oblivescence, which is the process of forgetting. Of the scenes occasioning and following the shock, severe headache, and a mental condition varying from slight depression to severe stupor. There was frequently a strong disinclination to talk of the forgotten periods, as if they were being actively inhibited or suppressed, rather than as if they have been passively disassociated. Now let me tell you too, it's in the interest of the devil, as you're a born-again Christian, to hide those things from you, so that you won't go to God and get healed and get dealt with and get the demons out. Because as long as he can hide it, he gets the free ride. He gets the free ride. They get to destroy you. You may be even functioning. Let me tell you something about deliverance. It's kind of wild. Because you can be obedient. And the more obedient you are, the less power the demons have. So you can still be chock full of demons and functioning. And you can be going along and you can be going to church and you can be tithing and you don't blow up and cuss people anymore. And all sorts of good things are happening because you're being obedient. But then the enemy is still there waiting for a weak moment to destroy you or to just go on to your children and see what he can do in that group. They're still there. There was a man named Win Worley many years ago, been here, some of his books here, and he talked about the cussing demon. He was talking to this group and he says, some of you lost 40 or 95% of your vocabulary when you got saved. You're obedient to God and you're walking along and you're not cussing anymore, and then you hit yourself with a hammer and boom, there it went. Because that demon was still under your tongue and needed to come out. How about all these folks that are getting dementia, Alzheimer's, that you're talking about old saints that have served the Lord. That now then, when their soul, their body is getting weak. How many know it's harder to be spiritually engaged and active when you don't feel good? So now as the body is deteriorating, and these old folks, their body is deteriorating, these demons have never been dealt with, their will is not as strong as it used to be, and all of a sudden, Grandma, who never cussed a day in her life, is cussing everybody she sees. Those are demons. And they're the result, listen to me, I do not believe for 1 minute that a saint that confessed their sins and stayed repentant will ever get in that state. But they never confess their sins. They never confess their second. Oh, they might have said, Jesus, I'm a sinner. And they might have said, I need you. And they were translated out of darkness and into the kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ. But they never specifically repented for individual sins and kicked the demons out. Everybody says, demons,
demons.
You're not staying in me.
You're not staying in me.
I don't want you.
In Jesus' name.
In all these cases, whenever the memories disassociated from the normal personality were revived, they were accompanied by outbursts of emotion, sometimes of frenzy, but generally of fear. It is natural to thrust aside painful memories, just as natural to avoid dangerous or horrible scenes in actuality. And this is a natural tendency to banish the distressing, but it is especially pronounced in those whose powers of resistance have been lowered by the long continued strains of trench life, the shock of explosion and other catastrophes of warfare. So this is talking about people that were in a war. How many know we're in a war? So what it's saying is that the longer the abuse went on, the harder the things were, the more things that were piled on your plate, the more disaster that came across your life, the more hurts and the more rejections, the more likely you are to have some parts missing from your thought process. People around us encourage us to forget and move on. There's an obvious need to move on with life. Let me tell you something. I've been healed of a whole lot of things. A whole lot of things. I haven't forgotten any of them. Just heal. I've forgiven. I moved on. But now what I could do is say, well, that hurt me, but now I have a scar. I don't have an open wound anymore.
Yes.
So now I can even look and say, look, you know, this, you know, and it, you can barely even say, yes, look at this, but I'm healed. And look what Jesus did. So now I can stand up before you and tell you what the King has done for me. I'm not wounded. It doesn't bring back an emotional shock. It doesn't bring back a wound. It doesn't move me out of my position of the righteousness of God. It doesn't emotionally hurt me to tell you the stories because Jesus has healed me.
Yeah.
But I had to let the Lord bring that up in order to get healed. You can't just forget and move on. You have to be healed.
Amen.
Forgive. And move on. Amen? Without the healing power of Jesus, you may move on, but you're still attached to the event, the people, and the spirits that invade with every traumatic experience. The frequency of amnesia, the Holocaust survivors, as children, they're encouraged not to tell, but to lead normal lives and forget the past. Holocaust survivors. I don't reckon any of them without deliverance ever led a normal life. You know, your own Holocaust is a personal Holocaust. The most pervasive preoccupation of child survivors is the continuing struggle with memory, whether it's too much or too little. For a child survivor today, an even more vexing problem is the intrusion of fragments of memory. A piece here and a piece there. Most are emotionally powerful and painful, but make no sense. They seem to become more frequent with time and are triggered by thousands of subtle and not so subtle events. Here's a quote. So much of my childhood between the ages of 4 and 9 is blank. It's almost as if my life was smashed into little pieces. The trouble is when I try to remember, I come up with so little. The ability to forget was probably my way of surviving emotionally as a child. Even now, when anything unpleasant happens to me, I have a mental garbage can in which I can put all the bad stuff and forget it. I'm still afraid of being hungry. I never leave my house without some food. Again, I don't remember being hungry. I asked my sister and she said we were hungry. So I must have been, I just don't remember. Karma will work to maintain the open wound for demonic activity, including confusion, insecurity, betrayal, disillusion. Cases of trauma open up the individual for sexual abuse, bullying, domestic violence, indoctrination, alcoholism, addictions. And look, seeing death can bring spirits of death and terror and the fear of death. Happens a lot to firemen, policemen, people that have to come on scenes. I had a man come up to me, and he'd become a volunteer fireman about his second week. They had a crash in, near our town, and about 8 high school kids got killed. And he came upon that scene. And a week later, we're sitting there, and he pulls me aside. He says, man, will you pray for me? I can't sleep at night. I'm having these images and all that. Well, what he had seen with his eyes brought trauma to him. And so we were able to break that and command the spirits to leave. And he was able to sleep, and that left him. How many know some of our people, maybe that are first responders and soldiers and stuff, never recovered? That's why you have PTSD and all that. It's because of what they've seen and what they've heard and what they had to do and what was done against them. Trauma can be replayed emotionally even if the memory is repressed. So you're reacting in your emotions to what the trauma was because something comes along that's familiar to it, but you never put how you're acting to what you encountered. It can trigger unexpected anger with the danger of anger always present. Triggers can bring fear. They result in panic attacks. Undealt with trauma can bring numbness or the need to be numbed. And so drug use, things that make you... Listen, you know what the point of drugs is? The ones that numb you down? It's to make you so numb the demons can't even use you. Because it blocks us from God. But that's the purpose. Now, they'll try. But, you know, the more you number, you can be pretty peaceful. But it's a place of no fellowship with God. And ultimately, they're just working their destruction against us. There'll be emotional flatness. You can be preoccupied, distant. There can be coldness, despair, loss of self-esteem, the replay. In cases where trauma is remembered, there can be images, thoughts, flashbacks, nightmares, paranoia, and sleeplessness. Insomnia occurs when a person is not at peace. You don't sleep at night, there's something wrong. That's part of the blessing of God. Psalm 3, read it. You should read it. If you have problems sleeping, read it. Declare it over your life. David is his people have been taken, and the Arabs have come on their camels called Midianites, and they took all the people. And David is sitting there, and he lays down at sleep, and he says, although I'm surrounded by thousands of enemies, I lay my head down and sleep. That's our heritage. You're fighting a war at night. Man, I want to go to sleep, just sleep good. Huh? You want to sleep good. Not as an escape, but as a place of rest so your body heals and you recharge for the next day. Amen?
Amen.
Say, Lord.
Lord,
thank you for good sleep.
Thank you for good sleep.
I thank you, Lord.
I thank you, Lord.
As I'm getting cleansed, as my conscience is clear, as your truth comes into me, fear goes. I can trust you to keep me while I sleep. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Shock can follow traumatic experience and bring its own stupor, its own anxiety, its own overactivity, its agitation, its impaired judgment, its confusion, its detachment, and its depression. So what's the answer to it all? Jesus. Amen. Luke 2:32 says He's a light for the revelation of the Gentiles and the glory of Thy people Israel. John 12:46 says, I am come into the world as light, that everyone that believes on me may not abide in darkness. Mark 4:22 says, for there's nothing hidden which shall not be manifest, made manifest, nor does any secret thing take place, but that it should come to the light. Hidden wounds bound by trauma manifest in unholy actions and hindrances that prevent us from being all that we can be in Christ. When I first learned about trauma, I was walking out of the house one day, and there's a TV show on, and there's a woman, her name is Joan Hunter, and And her parents were called Charles and Frances Hunter. They had a great healing ministry. They didn't get saved until they were 60 and began walking with the Lord. And in their 90s, they had a healing explosion in the Astrodome. Praying for people to get all sorts of miracles happening. But Joan Hunter was sitting there, and I caught with my ear just that she's talking about trauma. And she made this statement. She says, what we begin to learn is that trauma acts like glue to hold everything else in. And she said, so what we learned is that when we would tell trauma to leave, all of a sudden all sorts of other things would leave. And so that's all I heard. Walked out the door, the next person I ministered to, I said, trauma come out. Trauma came out, bunch more did after it. Amen? Does everybody say trauma?
Trauma.
You have no part of me.
You have no part of me.
I'm getting rid of you.
I'm getting rid of you.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Hidden wounds bound by trauma manifest in unholy actions and hindrances that prevent us from being all that we can be in Christ. The Lord is the light who shall bring up these hidden works of darkness. Matthew 7:7 says, ask and it shall be given to you. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened to you. Can I ask you, are you willing to ask? Are you willing to seek? Are you willing to knock?
Yes.
We need to ask the Lord to show us any open wound left in our lives. When there's open wounds, we face the issue of commonality. What commonality means you're going to be affected by spirits similar in nature to what has invaded our wounds. Okay? Let me tell you something. What we find is that ministered to people that say they had a crack cocaine problem. Okay? And God has set them free from that. Delivered. But for maybe a few years afterwards, this person, when they would go near those areas, it would bother them. You know what I'm saying? Now, listen, once you've been down those roads, once you've been down the drug roads, once you've been out, hey, listen, you know. You know when somebody else is up, you know, what they're doing, because you've been there. You know. If you walk that path, you know. And it doesn't matter. There's no denial, no anything else. You know that you know that you know because you've been there. God sets you free. You've been there. Okay? But there comes a place. So for those few years, you couldn't drive through those areas without being bothered. Okay? All right? A place of being bothered because the wound was still open. Okay? Now later when the wound was healed, so the demons were out, the victory was at hand as far as using or not, alright? The victory was at hand, but the wound was still open. But when the wound got healed, it's closed, now you drive through the same area and they learned, oh, this is a trap. Well, we can pray for them. I'm not moved and bothered. Okay? So we want to get to a place where we're healed and the trauma is out and then we're not bothered. And it, now listen to me, and this is a phenomenon that happens sometimes. You got to avoid it at all costs. And that phenomenon is you get delivered and you get healed, and the enemy will try to get you to work judgment on somebody still in what you were in.
Yes, right.
And that is a trap.
Yes.
It is a trap. If my wife was up here, she would tell you that at one point in her life, she was addicted to pills and having that deal, and she looked down on the crack addicts thinking she was a high-class addict because she got hurt from the doctor. That would be her worst. And it wasn't a year later that the crack houses were her in heaven. She began to go there. Because that judge not, you shall not be judged, and the same way you judge with, measure back to you, came to her house. Okay? So avoid, listen to me, church. You want to walk in freedom? It doesn't mean we don't judge right or wrong, because we do. But we don't ever judge anybody as if you couldn't do what they're doing if you were there in their life and raised by their parents with their ancestors. Because the truth is, if you were them, you'd be doing exactly what they were. Only by the grace of God are you not doing some of them. Amen? Right. So we keep ourselves by the grace of God. There we go. We keep ourselves humble before the Lord. And then when you see something wrong, you become an intercessor praying for people instead of condemner. Condemning them, because by the way, as a Christian, you are now the most powerful people in the world, whether you know it or not.
Yes.
Because the Holy One of Israel resides in you, and there's no Holy Ghost Junior. You have all the power in the world. And you have been put on the earth actually to judge the world, to judge the demons. to judge right and wrong in a holy manner. So when you call, you see somebody and you go get in an agreement with the enemy about them instead of praying for them, you're actually lending your agreement to the enemy to further his attack on that person and make it worse. Say, I have no agreement
with the enemy
in Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Thank you, Lord. Say, Lord,
Lord,
I'm asking you
even right now,
to begin to show me
any
open wounds that need to be healed. I'm giving you permission to heal me and trust in you to walk me through this. In Jesus' name. We need to apply the blood of Jesus to any remaining open wounds as the Lord takes us through this process. We'll have to forgive the persons, places, and circumstances as He brings things to remembrance. The Lord will choose the timing of this healing, and He can heal many at once, or He can heal one at a time. We just need to submit to His Lordship. There's been lots of repentance going on in here. Thank you, Lord. We love it when people are honest. Amen. That's what, when you get real, you repent. And when you repent, listen, the foundation of all freedom is repentance. No repentance, no freedom. It just stops right there. There's none. You don't repent. And the level and the measure to which you're willing to repent will determine the level and the measure of your walk. And that isn't kind of repentance says, oh, I'm a doll here. I'm your child. I received my righteousness, but Lord, this was wrong, and I take accountability for it. Please forgive me.
Yeah.
Now shut up, devil, in Jesus' name.
Yeah.
You hear what I'm saying? But be open and honest with the Lord. Let Him be God. Say, Lord,
Lord,
I apply the blood of Jesus,
to any open wounds in my life.
Thank you for the ones you're going to heal today.
Thank
you for the ones that might be a process.
But
I thank you the blood of Jesus is going to keep the demons that we've been ejecting and the ones that are about to come out from coming back in. In Jesus'
name.
You need to learn to deploy the blood of Jesus as a weapon. The Lord has given it to us, and it kept the angel. The pattern of that was established in the Old Testament when you see the Passover and when they painted the blood of the spotless lamb on their doorpost and on their lintels, and the angel of death had to pass over. And His blood has been given to us. We plead the blood when we go into the Lord saying, Lord, I messed up. I'm pleading the blood. You're going to court. And you're going through the blood, through Jesus. Amen? But then the blood of Jesus is strong. It's a barrier. You put it on your doorpost. Listen, you put the blood of Jesus over your mind. You put the blood of Jesus on you. You put the blood of Jesus on your body. You put the blood of Jesus on your marriages. You put the blood of Jesus on your children. You put the blood of Jesus on your finances. You put the blood of Jesus on everything that pertains to you. And you declare in the name of Jesus, anything passing through to me has to come through the blood. In Jesus' name. Matthew 18:19 says, again I say unto you, that if two of you shall agree on the earth concerning any matter, and whatsoever it may be that they shall ask, it shall come to them from my Father who is in the heavens. Do you agree that trauma and all associated spirits have to go?
Yes.
We all agree?
Yes.
Amen. So it says that it's going to happen.
Yes.
Power and agreement. Many times if I find stubbornness in a deliverance, I'll just stop and we'll say, did you repent? Yes. Did you hear that? Yes. Do you agree they have to go? Yes. You? Yes. You? Yes. Now go. In Jesus' name. And they go. Thank you, Father.
Yes.
Ephesians 5:8 says, for you were once darkness, but now light in the Lord. Walk as children of the light. Are you willing to walk in the light? Now, there was a skit by a group called the Skit Guys, worth watching. It's called God's Chisel. And there's a man playing God, and there's another guy lined up to get worked on by God, and they're going through a process. It's really pretty funny, but it's really pretty touching, too. And at one point, the man playing God asked the other guy, he says, what do you see when you look in the mirror? And the guy goes, me. And he goes, you're supposed to see my son. But then he says, I made you good. Be good. As a wise man of God, I've heard him say, just be good.
and choose to be obedient. That's, you know, there's so many weapons of God. The blood of Jesus, the name of Jesus, and praise, and worship, and prayer, and fellowship. All those things, but one of the most important weapons you have is just pure obedience. Just choose to believe God loves you, and that in the obedience, and listen, I told you the other day, He's not a control freak. He's not trying to control a bunch of little humans. He's God. He's magnificent. What He wants is you to partner with Him so He can keep you and bless you and hold you and love you and heal you and use you then to get some others out of darkness. Amen? Listen, if that wasn't the deal, we'd all just die and go home as soon as we got saved. Right? I mean, what's the point of being here? Huh? We're in this whole world because He wants to use us as an example that others can see. So I'm going to ask you again, are you willing to walk in the light?
Yes.
Amen. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father,
You're the God
of Abraham,
of
Isaac,
and Jacob.
All glory is yours. You're my deliverer,
my shield,
and my buckler.
You're my front guard.
You're my rear guard.
I come to you now
in the name of our awesome King,
Jesus.
And I ask you as a little child
for your light to shine into my life.
Get the revelation of that. Jesus said, He looked at a little child and He says, unless you come to the kingdom like this, you won't enter. What does that mean? It means, you're my daddy. I need you. I can't do anything without you, but I'll do whatever you want me to. You know, a little child asks, if he come to his daddy and he asks for a drink of water. And some of us have a hard picture of that because we didn't have a good daddy. But now I'm telling you, this daddy of ours is a great daddy. And He wants to meet every need. He wants to heal. He wants to bless. And so, I involve Him in everything I do. I'm not a carpenter. He taught me how to do it. Okay? Anything I have, I'm telling you, any project I do, anything I'm about to do, everything I do, I say, okay, Lord, I'm thanking you. You're doing it with me.
Yes.
And I can't do without you. So you decide how much do you want to do on your own, or how much do you want to do with the Lord? Because it's up to you. Say, Lord Yahweh. In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
I'm asking you again. To show me any open wounds. From trauma and shock in my life. I'm asking you for healing.
In these areas.
I believe you'll show them to me. Because I'm a child of your light. And not of darkness.
I'm asking you
to show me.
What I need to do
as my part
of the healing process.
I'm asking you
for your strength
in Christ Jesus
to help me
as we walk this out,
where I have sinned myself
as a result of these wounds.
I take responsibility
and I ask for the gift
of godly sorrow
that leads to repentance.
I declare in advance
that it's my choice of will
to forgive everyone,
including myself.
Thank you, Lord,
in advance
for your love and grace
in granting me victory
over the darkness.
I thank you
that from this day forward,
trauma
will not be the glue
that binds wounds open
and demons together,
as trauma
has no place in me.
I bind the strong man
assigned against me
in Jesus' name.
I apply the blood of Jesus
against the strong man.
I bind and break
all demonic shields
and seals
and prayers.
I submit to your Lordship, Jesus.
And I believe
that according to Luke 10:19,
you've given me authority
over all the power of the enemy.
I believe you've commanded me
and
all believers
to
cast out demons
in Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
I agree
that as my brother in Christ
calls out spirits,
calls out demons,
they have to leave. All whose legal right is broken.
And I also believe
that the squatters
whose legal rights have been stripped
in the past 2 days
have to come out as well.
In Jesus' name.
I agree
that
all life spirits
have to leave.
In Jesus' name.
I believe
that where the Spirit of the Lord is,
there is liberty.
And I believe
that
who the Son sets free
is free indeed.
I receive
the
salvation
and deliverance
of the Lord.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Father.
Now, we've been breaking a lot of soul ties, but specifically I'm going to pray that the Lord show you who you need to break soul ties with where trauma came in. Okay? And so I'm going to pray that. And in the name of Jesus, once listen, when that face comes to you, when a name comes to you, just do this. Just do this. Just do this. And I'll lead you in a prayer in a minute, but you just do it. Those things are being broken. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you for showing your children any unholy soul ties that they have developed that they is linking them to trauma and to traumatic experiences from incidences and from people.
In Jesus' name.
Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. We break those things in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father, for bringing them to mind in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. All those ties severed, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Now, keep chopping as I'm speaking. In the name of Jesus,
I break unholy soul ties
with all these people. In Jesus' name, I send their soul and spirits to them. Call mine back to me. Cleansed by the blood of Jesus. I break all unholy blood covenants. I break all demonic bridges between me and these people. I do forgive them, Lord. I command
all the spirits
that transferred into me
to
these soul ties
to leave
in Jesus' name. Take a deep breath. Come on out of them now in the name of Jesus. Come on out now in Jesus' name. Every spirit from those ungodly ties in the name of Jesus, come out now in the name of Jesus. Go, 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 go. In the name of Jesus. Come on out now. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. The Lord rebuke you in the name of Jesus. Abuse spirits, I break your power in the name of Jesus. We're going to call them out now in the name of Jesus. Amnesia, come out in the name of Jesus. Go, 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 go. Disassociation, come out. Shock, come out. Improperly motivated forgiving, come out in the name of Jesus. Suppression, come out in the name of Jesus. More shock, shock, get out of them in the name of Jesus. Shocking. Go. I pull the hammers out of their chest in the name of Jesus. I pull the knives out of their back in the name of Jesus. Go, 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 go. Headaches go. Frenzy go. Fear go. Lurking fear go. Paranoia get out. Insomnia get out. Nightmares get out. Mare spirits get out. Terror get out. Horror go. Severe stress. Moderate stress. Trifling stress. Painful memories go. Flashbacks. Replays. Get out of God's people in the name of Jesus. Go, 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 go. Loose them. Get out in the name of Jesus. Bullying spirits. Physical abuse. Child abuse, verbal abuse, sexual abuse. Go, 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 go. Get out in the name of Jesus. I pull you off trauma. You're not going to hold these in anymore. Get out. All trauma. Get out of them in the name of Jesus. Go, go, go. Trauma from 1 to 5. Trauma from 5 to 10. Trauma from 10 to 15. Trauma from 15 to 20. 20 to 30. 30 to 40. 40 to 50. Come out of God's people in the name of Jesus. 50 and above. In the name of Jesus. Old trauma come out. New trauma come out. Get out of God's people in the name of Jesus. Indoctrination, be gone. Initiation, be gone. In the name of Jesus. Violator,
Go from God's people in the name of Jesus. Molestation, go. Incest, go. Unclean, go. Insecurity, go. Confusion, go. Insecurity, all of you, clump up and come out. Come out of their sinuses now in the name of Jesus. Break up. Lust of the flesh. Lust of the eyes. Pride of life. Get out of them in the name of Jesus. I break that unholy threefold cord. Get out of God's people now in the name of Jesus. Bipolar, go. I break your power in the name of Jesus. Unstable, get out now in the name of Jesus. Manic depressive, obsessive compulsive, held in by that trauma, get out in the name of Jesus. Impaired judgment, I break your power. Anger, seething anger, agitation, betrayal, revenge, say in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I repent for any vows I've made.
I repent for any vows I've made.
Inner vows.
Inner vows.
Outer vows.
Outer vows.
Any words I've spoken,
any words I've spoken
that have anchored me
in the flesh
and taken me out of the grace of God. I break the powers of those vows. I command the spirits that enforce those vows to go now in the name of Jesus. If you said these words, I'll never love again. If you said these words, nobody will ever hurt me again. If you said those words, you put up a demonic shield of protection, but the Lord's love can't flow to you and through you. You have to be willing, listen to me, we have to be willing to get so healed that we can be hurt and just move on and love people anyway.
And
because
then,
it happens a lot. Yes, ma'am.
Trauma can come down the generation where you might not ever feel like you were.
Exactly.
Yeah. Any trauma, but your mother, father was in trauma. But, you know, pray like.
Say, Lord,
Lord,
I break the power,
of generational
shock and trauma and all that pertains
to
these spirits. Command everything that came generationally to go in Jesus' name. Deep breath. Come on out now in the name of Jesus. Come on out now in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. I break the power of the trauma from slavery. I break the power of the trauma from the trail of tears. I break the power of trauma from indentured servants. I break the power of the abuse of people in the name of Jesus. Go, 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 go. In Jesus' name. Go. All confusion, get out of God's people. In Jesus' name. Revenge. In the name of Jesus. Come out of them now. In the name of Jesus. Wanting revenge. I break your power. In Jesus' name. Fear. Anxiety. Panic. Terror. Numbing. Say, I give up. On being numb. I'm releasing that. The Holy Spirit's enough for me. Receive my comfort from the Holy Spirit from this point forward in Jesus' name. I repent for all false comforters. I break the power of those idols. Command those spirits to go in Jesus' name. Now deep breath. Come on out now in the name of Jesus. Every spirit that numbs, that makes seek numbness, I break your power in the name of Jesus. Go, 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 go. Flat spirits, emotionally flat spirits, I break your power. Dazed, despair, hyperactivity, withdrawal, detachment, depression. I break the power. I break the threefold cord of discouragement, disappointment, depression, heaviness. Go, 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 go. Put on a garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. I break the power of heaviness. I break the power of the isolator. In the name of Jesus, come out of God's people. Say, everybody say, I repent. Fear, doubt, and unbelief. I command those spirits to go. And along with all hindering spirits that hinder deliverance. Get out now. In Jesus' name. Deep breath. Come on out of them. Fear, doubt, unbelief, disappointment, discouragement, depression, heaviness. Go, 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 go. Unforgiveness, bitterness, hatred, locked up in trauma. Break your power. In the name of Jesus. Jealousy, go. Jealousy, go. Murder, go. Shame, go. False identity, go. Lost identity, go. Fractured identity, go. Rejection, go. Self-hatred, get out now in the name of Jesus. We rout you in the name of the Lord Jesus. Death from what I've seen. Death from what's been seen.
death from the wages of sin, death from the loss of a loved one, bondage, control, witchcraft, sorcery, manipulation, rebellion, domination, and bullying. Get out of God's people now in the name of Jesus. Go, take a deep breath, let them go. Let them go, let them go. Come on out now. All bondage, fear again to bondage, I break your power. Bondage again to fear, I break your power in the name of Jesus. All witchcraft, all sorcery, manipulation, rebellion, domination, bullying, all of you come out of God's people in the name of Jesus. Say, Lord.
Lord.
I give up.
I give up.
Mourning.
Mourning.
And grief.
And grief.
Perpetual mourning.
Perpetual.
And perpetual grief. It's time for me to move on. I give up being brokenhearted.
I give up being brokenhearted.
I give up having a shattered heart.
I give up having a shattered heart.
I belong to the Lord.
I belong to the Lord.
And I receive healing.
I receive healing.
So every spirit called brokenhearted, shattered heart,
wounded heart,
you have to go.
Every spirit
that bruised
my human spirit,
you have to go in the name of Jesus. And all that mourning,
all
the grief,
go now
in Jesus' name. Now deep breath, saints, come on out of them. Come on out of God's people, the mourning, the grief, the wounded heart, the shattered heart, the broken heart, in the name of Jesus. Turn loose them now in the name of Jesus. Go, 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 go. These are God's children. You have no right of place. Let them go in the name of Jesus. Let them go in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. He is a good, good Father.
Yes,
he loves us. He loves His people so much. Say, Lord,
Lord,
help me to love You.
Help me to love You.
Help me to understand Your love.
Help me to understand Your love.
Help me to receive Your love.
Help me to receive Your love.
Help me to give Your love to others.
Help me to give Your love to others.
Now raise your hands to heaven, if you will. I speak life to your children, Lord. I'm going to speak over you now. I speak life unto your children, Lord. I ask you to cleanse their bodies of any toxins, any chemicals released through trauma, or any other source. To restore any damaged DNA. To heal their immune systems, Lord. Heal their broken hearts. To continue to erase the unholy pictures and the words and the sensual memory as they allow you, Jesus, to remove any disorder, disease, or disharmony from their bodies in the name of Jesus. I speak, Father, to their hypothalamus glands in the name of Jesus, and I speak you reset in Jesus' name. I break the power of the demons and command them to come out of the hypothalamus, that would keep them engaged in the fight or flight on a continual basis. I break the power of that. I speak a reset. I speak a reset in their hormones in the name of Jesus in the control center, which is the hypothalamus. I speak a disconnect in the automatic failure and reaction mechanisms that are set by the demons. I break that in the name of Jesus. I thank you, Father. I command the trauma and shame associated with sin and attached to the skin to flee now in the name of Jesus. Get out in the name of Jesus. And receive from the Lord as things are leaving, as the goodness of God is coming in, the enemy has to flee. In the name of Jesus, I declare, Father, they have identity in Jesus and a life more abundant. I declare they'll love you with all their heart, with all of their mind, and all of their strength, and they shall love their neighbors as they love themselves. In Jesus' name, now, I command any remaining, and listen, just start shaking your hands now. In the name of Jesus, I command any remaining trauma, shock, terror, shame, to come out of God's people in Jesus' name. Come out of their muscles. Come out of their ligaments. Come out of their tendons. Come out of their bones. Come out of their marrow. Come out of their heart, their lungs, their liver, their kidneys, their bowels, their spleen, their pancreas, appendix, their eyes, their stomach, their reproductive organs, their brain, their amygdala. In the name of Jesus, I turn off the alarms in Jesus' name. I turn off the alarms in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. Come out of their eyes, their ears, their noses. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name.
The people that have traumatized their forefathers through slavery.
Yes, Lord. Say, Lord,
Lord,
I forgive anybody that ever tried.
traumatized.
Any of my ancestors.
In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Now say, thank you, Lord. That you would fill every void where the enemy's left. With perfect love. That cast out fear. Fill me up. Holy Spirit, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Bless them, Lord. Bless them, Lord.
I'm going to teach you just a minute. Thank you, Father.
Now listen to me. I tell you right now, even as we're going through this, if the Lord, you know, if He continues to show stuff, just keep chopping. Okay? Just keep chopping. Okay?
Keep chopping. Because let me tell you something.
You're here. We're delighted you're here. We want you to walk this thing out.
Yes.
We want you to walk in victory. Come back. Get some more. Keep doing this. But walk this thing out and dominate your enemy. Make him pay for everything he's done for you.
Yes.
By loving God and loving your neighbor. Amen?
Yes.
All right. So right here is kind of the circle. These are gates. Open gates. Open doors that allow sin, that allow spirits to come in. Okay? So, first of all, there's sins. You got unforgiveness. You got sexual sins. You got divorce. How many know we've probably repented for everything here?
Yes.
Amen?
Amen.
There's a picture. I'm going to leave it up here. Anybody wants to take a picture, can take a picture. In the name of Jesus. There's a cult. There's divorce. There's curses. There's generational issues. There's tongues. That's words spoken over you. We dealt with some of those today. Amen? Vows. Death wishes. We dealt with vows a minute ago. That's those things we speak. And listen, a demon takes care of the vow. They enforce those things. We've come out of agreement with them. Objects, things you have in your home, involuntary exposure. You didn't ask to see it. It just came before your eyes. Then there's secrets. Of course, you can have voluntary exposure in which you look on unclean things and open doors. So now you got hurt, pride, sexual abuse, rejection, trauma, a bad image of God. See, where it says image of God, that means you don't look at Him right. That means because your own parents, your father and your mother, and the places they failed you, you failed to see God for the truth of who He is and how much He loves you and what His truth. Now listen, the Scripture says the promises of God are yes and amen. You need to read the Bible and find out what His promises are. And any place in your life you're not seeing that, you repent and tell the devil to get out. And he can't steal from you what God has promised you. Okay? Then there's your self-image. Everybody say, I love me.
I love me.
Because God made me special.
Amen?
So if you're having trouble loving yourself, my prescription to everybody is we cast these demons out, we repent for that. Listen, by the way, it's sin. So let everybody say, Father, if I've been in self-hatred,
I
confess that it's sin.
You made me valuable.
To be loved.
Not to be hated.
So I break agreement with that.
And
I forbid those demons
to
attack my body anymore. Because they agree with my soul. Because
my soul
now blesses the Lord and blesses myself. In Jesus' name. Amen. So look in the mirror every day and say, you know what? I love you. You're fearfully and wonderfully made. Might seem a little awkward, and that's not the puffed up look at me thing. That's the, I accept you. God made you special. And you look in the mirror and you establish that in your life. Okay? Alright? So there's that. Alright. You got to recognize what it is. You got a problem? You got to recognize it. Got a sin problem, there's something going on, something's not functioning. First of all, you got to know there's a problem. And then when you know it's a problem, you seek to remove the problem, you pull out, listen, always remember this, bad fruit has a bad root. Okay? Listen, bad fruit has a bad root. So the anger, the rejection, the fear, all those things that came in when you're a little person results in the stuff that we do. Later on in life. There's a chart over there, rejection. See its fruits and its roots? Everybody ought to study that tree. And there's even a chart over there. You can buy the chart. And it shows you, go down to the roots. Because listen, what happens if you pluck root fruit off a tree?
It dies.
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
No, it grows back.
Oh, I thought you said if you pluck the root.
Not if you pluck the root. There you go, sister. Now if you pluck the root, the tree dies. But if you just take the fruit off, the fruit's coming back. You've got to go for the root. Responsibility. We have to take responsibility, accountability. When I look at something, I want to take accountability. Sometimes we take accountability generationally. That's not even something we did. It's like Carter was saying earlier. There are some things that didn't happen to her, but they happened up the tree. And so she was suffering for it, not even having a clue why. But it was just as if it had happened. So I had personal deliverance with many people, and I've seen times where we're breaking generational curses, and something's coming up, and they're going, "Well, I ain't never done that." And you know the spirits are there, and they won't come out until that person gets the understanding that they're not saying they did it, but they're taking accountability for what happened up your family tree, up your family line. You must call sin sin without blame shifting. You don't blame it. You don't blame your sin and on anybody else if you want to get healed. You don't shift it on any person or any circumstances. You just say, "Lord, what I did, I did. I have no excuse except the blood of Jesus, and I'm coming to you through it." Amen? Amen. It's not an excuse, but that's my plea. So listen, what we've been doing, when we're repenting, we're going to court. How many here have been to court? So when you go to court, do you see who? The judge. Okay? So the Bible says that the devil is the accuser of the brethren who goes before the throne of God night and day accusing the brethren. He's accusing us. If he doesn't have anything to say, there's no charge that can come against us. Okay? But if there's something happening, so look, all those open gates that we showed, soul ties, and I don't even think it was on there, it might have been, but soul ties are an open gate, an open door. So we inherit open doors, gateways. We inherit them. We have soul ties that do them. Our own sin does it. What we join to does it. What people do to us opens doors. Okay? We want to close all those doors. Right? But the only way I can do that is to come and take accountability for my part of it and repent. And repent for my ancestors. So we shift no blame. Amen? Everybody say, "Lord,
Lord,
I did it.
I did it.
Forgive me.
Forgive me.
I need your forgiveness.
I need your forgiveness.
And I receive your forgiveness.
And I receive your forgiveness.
In Jesus' name."
In Jesus' name.
Okay, we got to repent, forgive. I'm going to tell you this. If you don't remember anything I've told you, remember what I'm about to tell you. Be quick to repent and be quick to forgive. The quicker you repent, the better it gets. The quicker you repent, the more you start dominating the enemy. And you don't let sin go on. You don't let anger. You don't let the sun. How many have ever let the sun go down on your wrath? Do you know that sin? And it says if you do, you give place to the devil. How many want to give him a place? I don't want him having any habitation around me. So we learn to repent quickly and then forgive quickly. So the repent part is me. The forgive part is these out here. Okay? So the minute I start feeling offended, I'm going, "I forgive them, Lord."
Yeah.
Immediately. I don't wait. Listen, if the sun goes down at 7, don't wait till 6:59 to fix it. Okay? Start immediately letting people go. Just refuse to be offended. Okay? Repent from falling for the enemy's lies. Usually the experiences from open doors in their lives allow the enemy in. Even repent for ignorance, not knowing what you've become part of. How many know if you're speeding down the road and you tell the police officer, "I didn't see the sign"? How's that work? It don't work. "I didn't see that stop sign." Well, you will next time. A lot of times we don't even know that we have open doors. Forgive any person involved in sinning against you and with you. Forgive yourself. Forgive God if you're blaming Him. Even subconsciously, specifically repent for this. He's our only answer. If you've got a subconscious charge against God, you're stuck. And so you ask Him, "God, am I mad at you about this? If you feel stuck in a place, am I mad at you for this, Lord? I forgive you." He hasn't sinned against any of us. He doesn't sin. He doesn't need our forgiveness, but we need forgiving. So we open up for Him to bless us and help us and heal us. Break all unholy judgment. Make no charge against anybody. Break ungodly soul ties in Jesus' name.
Command their souls and spirits to go where they belong. Call your soul and spirit back to you. Cleanse by the blood of Jesus. Break all demonic bridges between you and the person or persons. Like what we've been doing. Every time. Thank you, Father. Renounce. And you must make what you recognize of your enemy and renounce it. Come out of agreement with ungodly actions. When we renounce, we're saying, I don't agree with this anymore. I don't agree with the action. I don't agree with this sin anymore. Not in my life. I don't agree for my children. I don't agree anymore. Renounce any part of your life that's not of God. Anything not of God is the enemy. And it's our enemy. Break the curses. Think of them like a contract. The sin of our ancestors and what's happened has made a contract, an agreement with the enemy that he could operate against our life. We need to break those things. Cast out the demons. If you meant it in repentance, they've got to go. The only time they don't leave is if there's not repentance. If they're maintaining a lie somewhere and you haven't come into agreement with God's Word. True repentance and relationship with Jesus strips their legal right to be there. So we go to the court, right? How many know that if you had a rent house and you had a bad tenant and you couldn't get them out, you'd have to go to the court?
Yeah.
And when you go to the court, you get an eviction notice, right?
Yeah.
That's what we do. So we go to the court, we make our petition, and we make that tenant who had a right to be there a squatter. Now we come back and serve the eviction notice. Get out in Jesus' name. Amen? When in doubt, cast it out. Carla heard about a cuckoo spirit. Okay? We've all heard weird stuff. And go, what? And then went, come out! And it does. So when you hear something funny against yourself or if you're ministering to somebody else, speak it. So when in doubt, cast it out. It is violent. It's a violent spiritual act. How many have seen a dog on a porch? If you go, go away, dog. Get out of here. Go away. He just looks at you like that. You go, get out of here in Jesus' name. Then he runs. Right? You make him scat in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. Yeah. Matthew 11:12. From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent take it by force. Okay? Remove it. This means get rid of the stuff. Listen, if you've got a pornography problem, get rid of your computer. If you have to have it for work, do it in the McDonald's. I see travel ministered to many people. Guys say, well, I've got to have it to travel. Well, I said, then don't open it up until you're in the McDonald's or in the lobby. Don't open it up. Don't get it out of your car. Don't take it into the hotel room. If the TV's a problem, unplug it when you go in. And if that's a problem, you can't do that. Go out and do somersaults when you start getting messed up. Do something to stop what the enemy's doing. Get rid of the stuff. We had a man of God, we know, got books around here, and he's publicly testified to this, but he had an anger problem even as a deliverance minister, and his wife was exasperated, and to the point of wanting to leave him. And he said, well, I don't want you to leave me. And he said, well, cast a demon out of me. So she did. And then they made a covenant, and their covenant was when she saw him getting mad, she would give them a code word, and when she gave him the code word, he'd stop whatever he was doing, and he would sit down on the ground. So he said for about 2 weeks he was sitting in the Walmart. He had to pull over the side of the road and sit down, but he sat down, and he said, and the thing is, you embarrass the devil before he embarrasses you. And because he arrested that, he changed the process. See, you've got to do something different. You don't do what you've always done. When you start feeling that way, you do something to change it. So his method was that. About 2 weeks, he had dominated the enemy to the point he didn't have to sit down at Walmart anymore. Thank you, Father. Okay? So listen, as you get rid of the junk, replace it in your life with godly activities. Put the things of God in. Just become saturated in loving God and being part of Him and His family. Amen? Okay. Whatever the enemy once owned in your life needs to be reclaimed. Everybody raise your hands to heaven. Say, Father, I give you me.
Father, I give you me.
I give you my life.
I give you
everything that pertains to me.
I
consecrate me and all that is mine to you. I ask you to make it holy and return it to me for the use of your kingdom. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
All right, Matthew 5:29. Let's go back on that scripture about getting rid of things. If the right eye offend you, pluck it out and cast it from you. For it is profitable for you that one of thy members shall perish and not the whole body should be cast into hell. Amen?
Amen.
We just need to do what we need to do. He's not really telling you to pluck your eye out, okay? He's telling you to do something different. Huh? Make something happen different. You got to resist.
Amen.
Every single person in here. Good news is we're getting delivered. Okay? Bad news is you're going to have to resist Him on your own one day. Okay? But you have the Holy Ghost. You have the name of Jesus. You have the blood of Jesus. You're a child of God. Amen? It's basically like this. Shut up, devil. You've got to respond. Okay? You have to respond. Listen. Luke 10:19. He's given us power to tread on the serpents and the scorpions over all the power of the enemy. But now look at 10:20. He said, notwithstanding this, rejoice not that the spirits are subject to you, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven. You know why the Lord put that in there? Because if we're not careful, we'll get prideful and think it's us. He works with us. And He won't work without us. But it won't happen without Him. And He gets the glory. So whatever, everything y'all received, everything you're going to walk out, everything you're going to do, it's none of us. We're just here being agreeing with our God on your behalf.
Yes.
Amen? And believing for you. But Jesus gets the glory all the time.
Yes.
Be careful to make sure He gets the glory.
Yes.
Amen? Ephesians 6:16. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith you shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. Now listen. In a nutshell, if it won't go through the Bible, it doesn't get to come in your mind. So if it's anything that slanders your character, demeans you, or tempts you to do something that you know God wouldn't want you to do according to the Word of God, you put up the shield of faith and you say, shut up, devil. I don't agree with you. I always say, listen, it says fiery darts. And I tell people, I said, look, if you were at the other end of the room and I had a bow and arrow and I put it in fire and it was a flaming fire and I pulled back the bow and I shot it at you and you didn't move, what would happen? You get hit. So every temptation, every unholy thought, those are fiery darts that you don't respond to, sticks. It sticks. Then you've got to pull it out. So it's just a matter of how much damage. But if you respond to it... So, in other words, the devil says, you should go over and slap him. Oh, shut up, devil. I'm not going to do that. Now listen, now you've got to swing the sword, though. Take the helmet of salvation. So you know you're saved, right? Huh? You're aware that you're saved. This guards your mind. Amen? So because I am saved, I belong to the Lord. I don't think like I used to. I have the helmet of salvation. So now I'm going to take the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. That means you need to take God's Word, that is the truth, and deploy it against the lie. So the devil says to you, you're not going to have enough. God's not going to take care of you. And you say, shut up, devil. God shall provide all of my needs according to Christ's riches in His glory. Devil says you're going to lose. Oh, shut up, devil. I am more than a conqueror through Christ Jesus. The devil says, why don't you go do this? Shut up, devil. I have put off the old man and put on the new. You declare God's Word as the sword. If you don't learn to declare the Word, you'll get tired telling the devil to shut up. But if you tell him to shut up and swing the sword, he'll go away and you'll leave just like you left Jesus. Jesus' temptation in the wilderness is your pattern for this. He used the Word against the devil every time. Rejoice. Rejoice. Give thanks to the Lord for setting you free. You're free from the bondage of the enemy's deception and having to live in fear. But you've got to cultivate joy with thankfulness, gratitude, and praise. Nehemiah 8:10 says, go your way. Now listen to this. Eat the fat, drink the sweet, and send portions unto them for whom nothing is prepared. For this day is holy unto our Lord. Neither be you sorry, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. God's saying, enjoy your life. I'll bless you. You'll eat of the fat of the land. You'll have enough to give to somebody that doesn't even have. If you'll just do what I have for you to do. But you've got to cultivate joy. If you feel yourself feeling down, start thanking God.
I tell people, thank you for your son. First of all, thank you, you're not going to hell anymore. Great base. We ain't going to hell. Everybody say, thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
I'm not going to hell. Amen. Praise the Lord. I heard an old preacher say the number one reason I got saved is I didn't want to go to hell. And I thought, well, that's a good reason. It is the number one reason. Now, but then thinking, you got socks, you got underwear, you got clothes, you got water, you got food, you got whatever it is. You're going to go through stuff. We go through stuff. But you thank God for what you have.
Yeah.
And the quickest way, listen, the quickest way through every trial is thankfulness.
Yeah.
And gratitude. The quickest way. And if you get sidetracked into grumbling, your trial just lasts longer. Okay? Yeah. The quickest way through every trial. Thank you, Lord, I know you're working this out. Thank you, Lord, you're a good God. Thank you, Lord, you have my best interest in mind. Thank you, Lord, I'm even going to grow from this. Thank you, Lord, I'll be stronger at the end of it. Thank you, Lord, you're my deliverer. Thank you, Lord, you're my strong tower. Thank you, Lord, your name is the strong tower that the righteous run into. Thank you, Lord, that you're good. Thank you, Lord, for your mercy. Thank you, Lord, for your grace. Thank you, God, that you're holy. Thank you, God. You are my deliverer that comes from Mount Zion. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. He's holy. Thank you, Lord. Now you go out. Sister spoke of this earlier. She's raising up a group of warriors here. She's depending on Jesus to help her.
Yeah.
Amen? But then you go out and you help someone else. You freely give what's been freely given. There's a saying that says, free people, free people. Amen? Hurt people, hurt people. So the freer we get, the more we can go out and help. And listen, not everybody is an evangelist. Not everybody's going to sit in front of a podium here and talk to people. But what you've got is a testimony.
Yes.
Somebody says, how are you doing? Well, it's raining outside, but I'm telling you, God is good.
Yes.
Huh? Let me tell you, He's good to me.
Yes.
He supplies my needs. He healed me. He
yes.
put my feet on. You start speaking what He did for you in your language.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
Grateful heart. That Charles and Francis Hunter I talked about earlier, they went into rally, I don't know if they're still alive anymore, but they go into a restaurant and they waiter or waitress would come up and they'd say, well, you know there's two kind of waiters in here? And they'd say, saved and the one's about to be saved. Which category are you in? Huh? Then they give them some testimony. Huh? When you share your testimony, you give someone else the hope that they can also be set free. The enemy is defeated by the testimony of Jesus Christ in your life. The enemy does not want you to have or share your testimony of Jesus Christ changing your life. He knows how powerful it is.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
May the Father bless you and keep you. I pray over the meal to come. I speak rest unto you. I speak ongoing healing and deliverance all the days of your life. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
This is the end of this message. Our website is www.LakeHamiltonBibleCamp.com. and LHBCOnline.com. There are many hundreds of free audio files there. It's like going to Bible school at home. Thank you.